Congratulations to the graduates. I like to think that our task henceforth is to protect the question. Philippe Lacoue-Labarthe has said that the 20th century has bequeathed three major modalities of thought. Those bound up with task, Benjamin, with struggle, Marx, with a sense of mission, Heidegger. Task, struggle, mission. These primary attitudes set by thought follow complicated itineraries and collapse cycles. Task, as Benjamin pointed out, turns against itself, is meant to flop. Aufgabe also carries giving up, losing the momentum of the assignment, failing the task. Walter Benjamin was failed in many ways on several levels. Let us reopen the case, if only to get at this time, for our purposes, an aerial view of the obstinate dilemma that his name still poses. To find our way to him, let us reflect together, more generally, on the constitution and deconstitution of an oeuvre, on the singularity of a signature, and maybe also on what it means to have had one's dissertation institutionally discredited. Or perhaps even more disastrously, what it might mean to have one's work institutionally approved. Sorry, Sophie. What kind of a dead letter box does this toss us and our own work into? Understanding that work has long been seen as a form of self-appropriation. So what is work? What is our work? Let us begin to walk the walk, here where Rousseau, Nietzsche, Adorno, and a score of others took their strides. Point 01. When do we sign for a text's arrival? Let us take into account the time warps, the distortions and delays to which any reception is subject, to the unrecognizability of the oeuvre when it arrives, its stealth approach, or noisy invasion, even at times the catastrophe it portends. Some texts arrive on the scene with the disruptive capacities of a natural disaster, a catastrophic overturning of tropes and conceptual alignments. These disturbances are not aleatory attributes, but part of a necessary disruption in the itinerary of any work of moment. The sense of catastrophic incursion or toxic spill into the field of reception is not far from the neighborhood, however air-filtered, where Heidegger indicated that if we are to find Nietzsche, we must first lose him. You remember that Zarathustra had told his disciples to get lost. Getting lost, says Heidegger, belongs to the structure of a text's arrival. In the case of Nietzsche, its most essential delivery system. We have to lose Nietzsche in order to find him, a first instruction in the user's manual. Where a text lands and how it transmutes is another, though related, question. Traumatically, in one of the orifices So where does a text arrive, even? All of Hamlet is organized around the invasion of the ear. And of course, Nietzsche was proud of his ears, too, his little labyrinthine ears, with its implied shuttle system to the anus, not Nietzsche. Psychoanalysis grasps word as body and tries to monitor the hits that one takes when riddled with language and the resignifying techniques, the attacks of sense-making, whether exact or off the mark, to which we are routinely bound. As Kant remarked, we don't know why some works enjoy popularity, even as they remain resistant, that is dense and difficult, nearly undecipherable. Why is it that everyone knows Rembrandt, Picasso, Nietzsche, Derrida, maybe Goethe and Rimbaud, and now Schopenhauer, even though some of these works at times defy entry and offer no easy pass to speak of? These questions form part of my reflection for this evening in the sublime alpine regions where we find and lose ourselves every day. Point 02. I ask that you extend me credit, that you allow me to establish an account with you that forgives from the start my paratactical organization, that is the disjunctive sequencing. I overprepared, which means that I shred and erase as I go along. I efface entire tropologies and fragile spans that take us from here to there, A to Z, New York to Saas-Fee, Berlin to Paris and back, Berlin to Ibiza, to Spain, an Einbahnstraße, one-way street, one-way ticket, I should say, in a stringently mapped oeuvre. I overprepared, which means I feel underprepared, constitutively underprepared, and vulnerable to the overexposure on which my relation to him pivots. I don't want to repeat myself, but the obsessional compulsion mode by which he has me going and returning on so many one-way streets, different textures of Holzwege, paths cut differently than that of Heidegger or Rousseau, or even of that premier bully who did dialectics in Athenian backstreet alleys, Socrates, I mean. Or think of Nietzsche's cadences, the way he walked the walk in this neighborhood and the other ambulant philosophers. Or think of the Deleuzian schizo stationary mobility and all the stalls and thwarts and necessary dead ends of the philosophical ways and byways. All of this has me running behind on repetition compulsion. I don't necessarily believe in running ahead of the curve, so don't feel too sorry for me. So Benjamin has won on repetition control, on a frenetic regimen of cutting away, ever missing in the action or radical passivity of writing. Running ahead, running behind, trucking and tracking, all Benjaminian motifs of which we are inheritors. For my part, running up his legacy, I have been cutting back and cutting down, editing and splicing, allegorically resetting, and voiding all sorts of aphoristic shots and stills. I'd like to say that when nowadays I think of my lifelong engagement with Benjamin, I need to place his signature incursion in terms of sequencing, more precisely as part of a scanning of sequelity, pitching how Benjamin keeps coming back as a sequel of himself. What is the sequel and how does it link us to others, to other singularities or texts? What kind of repetition or iteration is at stake? How is the very thought of sequence and sequel disruptive of the original work? Or does it allow the original to originate? The title of this presentation, or its second part, he liked us to start jamming on the second take. The title bears his name and offers a subject heading, the sequel. An overdetermined trope, it is meant to indicate one of the signs of non-sovereignty with which Benjamin associates Goethe's work on affinity. So non-sovereignty means here, circuited by a Goethe, when you can't really choose and your agency is really depleted, even when you think you're making certain decisions or you're affirming some sort of emancipatory libido. This is what Goethe taught Benjamin and us. Can one start over? How does reconfiguration augur? What kind of recycling mechanisms emerge in the effort to reshuffle destinal, or rather institutional cards in an era of aggravated contingency? How do beings relate to one another? How do works support the traumatic transfer of textual encounter, such as when Hölderlin's Blödigkeit, or stupidity, meets its match or mismatch in Dichtermut, in a dense poetic runoff? So I'm not interested merely or only in relations on the human scale of life, but also how texts take each other on and relate to each other, and also according to a kind of Nietzschean understanding, which Benjamin picks up in his way, of retraction. There are many texts or authors that retract a work by disinscribing it and trying to replace it with another work. Very often the second work that tries to correct or provide a correction to the first work is very conservative and recoils from its own radicality. So you have this in the relationship of two very important Hölderlin poems, and then also in Baudelaire, when he outbids his insights with the famously self-superseding poems in Correspondance, commented both by Paul de Man and Barbara Johnson. I am trying to establish here a kinship among texts and their commentators. What does it mean at all to arrange a rendezvous of texts and more or less force them to relate to one another, to a container or holding structure, even a holding pen, such as that of a lecture situation? Benjamin himself, when partnered up with Goethe, calibrated the affect of such encounters and took measure of scenes of non-transfer. So when texts can't show up for each other in a certain way, Benjamin was tracking the path of undead passion, I would say, something that keeps on returning with nearly mechanical coldness. He wrote the signifier, barely a word, yet an instigating force that attaches to a world of meaning. The trans, I was quietschvergnügt, or delighted to see that Judith Butler jammed on transience in Benjamin's text the other night. So the trans, the über, that which figures what Heidegger calls the transhuman. For Heidegger, it was a disaster that Nietzsche's Übermensch was translated as Superman, or the Surhomme. He wants a transhuman, recalibrating the meta of metaphysics. So what kind of Überreading accrues to the trans or falls away in the Benjaminian body, if sometimes phobically and with a bad conscience? We will certainly want to review its off-the-chart travel plans and persistent bookings in Benjamin's negotiations with an entire network of boundaries and tropological turnover. Of course, one has to wonder what it means to put an APB on a mere prefix and its possible supplements in order to kick off a reflection devoted to Benjamin's engagement with writing, technology, and image. APB means what the police signal when they're looking everywhere for a suspect or criminal, by the way. If we are stalled in the precincts of a barely floatable signifier, this is in part because we are locked into a site of lost transcendence and trailing language puns. We could say that the transmitters were KO'd long ago, a now vintage Benjaminian image, and that the signals are hitting our receptors only now. Point 03. In the Tour de Babel essay that some of us continue to study, Derrida, passing through or as Benjamin, opens up the eventfulness of our babelization, the many transgressions and boundary assaults that led to the punishing paybacks, the divine reactivity to the push for transparency, one language. "I don't think so," said Yahvé, kicking down the first skyscraper. Henceforth, to fast forward, translation ruled, always bringing home our broken relation to sense and meaning. So why could this be important for us today on graduation day, here, in ever-regressing territories of national religious anxieties and their destructive analogs? Benjamin set this on us, and Derrida clears the way. Babel means that you cannot say ever, simply, because the Bible says so. So God, for once being a really good guy, installed a translation clause into all our relations to the Bible, making it strictly uncitable. So that's the divine politics of citationality, that you'll never be able to say, ever since Babel at least, because the Bible says so. I am prohibited from saying anything with the secured sense of biblical injunction or assertion, because transparency is itself under biblical lock. The words are constitutively scrambled. Installed and at its core, the Bible trembles with rage under gag order because God herself or himself has launched the trans and forbidden any settlement with assured intention or meaning or election or sanction or homophobic announcement or clear-cut Occupy statement, to the extent that it, the Bible, has incorporated a trans machine, altering, transferring, transvaluating, transposing, and translating from the ground up endlessly. Traumatic norming comes into play only in the mode of delayed reactivity at the site of discredited utterance, a gift to and of divine violence. As for Benjamin, his relation to the rogue itineraries of the trans points to a rich and in part melancholic mapping that encompasses failed or stalled transits and blocked off transfers. Still, he'd sometimes manage to take an off-ramp and experiment with zones of transfigured sense. In Hashish in Marseille, so the experiential fugue goes to France. It's interesting that Benjamin relocates to France, which is designated as a gateway space where foreign bodies multiply. Benjamin tries to give a sense of what it is like to get high. I say this because I know some of you were partying last night. I put the emphasis on like, what it's like to get high, and the rhetoric of approximation. For like Thomas de Quincey before him, at the moment of saying his own most experience of altered consciousness, well, so-called consciousness is ever altering, but that's another story. He takes a swerve and quotes Baudelaire. De Quincey quoted Wordsworth when he tried to get inside his own head and set about securing the trope of interiority. So whenever any of these texts on drugs want to say what is going on when you're high or wasted or fucked up, they always start citational politics where an other is telling and describing your innermost experience. So there's a kind of, the texts are on each other. I call this elsewhere tropium. But this is still part of the intertextual transfer. In order to get inside, they go out, if we manage to avoid all the problems of introjection and incorporation, encrypted objects. I'm trying to ask where we locate our relation to the text of the other. So please put on your allegorical ears if they haven't already been fastened. Sometimes you smoke or snort or inject a text. At least psychically, that's what's happening. Or you are penetrated by it, lacerated, whiplashed, blindsided, or in a Kafkian thrall, the oncoming work ought to hit you like an axe in a frozen sea. These transfers are inevitably violent. Jump cut, take two, sequel. Due to time constraints, I have unloaded a good deal of this exposé, set it aside so that what I have to offer can be grasped more than any other generic marks along the lines of a teaser, maybe a trailer. Shots, cuts, jump cuts, the whole lexicon of abbreviated maneuvers that relinquish the poses of mastery that graduate lecture implies. Rushing to the encounter of Walter Benjamin today, I slalom between the poles and varieties of hot and cold media. I travel to zones of utterance and intricacy for which Benjamin is celebrated or watered down, even dumbed down and avoided. It seems as though Walter Benjamin should not be vulnerable to acts of dumbing down, which can take the form of aggressive familiarity with his works and its contours, a stabilized sense of its mappings, pitfalls, blurs, the types of leakage for which it is responsible. I have been interested in the leaks in the body of Rousseau's oeuvre recently, the WikiLeaks that he recounts in the Reveries of a Promeneur Solitaire. Benjamin belongs to that kind of configuration that unleashes parasitic utterance or flies under the radar, bypasses the main checkpoints of legitimated thought. Yes, even in our day. When Hannah Arendt wrote her introduction for him, she said that Benjamin was a mere rumor, a pre-spectral emergence on a very high-tech detection system. These are not her words exactly, but perhaps a media technological translation of how she sought to present this rumorological speck that resisted his own spectacularity and advent. Just a few years ago, it seems, I was in conversation with Levinas, who refused Benjamin a pass in our zone of intense discussion when I suggested that there was a point of comparison between two motifs in their work, a moment of possible reciprocation. He said dismissively, "You mean that, that," and he switched to German, "that mere Schriftsteller? Mais non. Ach, ach. Verneinung, Verwerfung, Verschieben." Yes, let's displace. Let us look for and possibly affirm the dislocation with which the name of Benjamin is still associated. Ach, ach. The discrediting of Benjamin as lacking the proper ID for philosophical and speculative thought. This still happens. Just a few years ago, it seems, Philippe Lacoue-Labarthe told me that he could not pass a program with Benjamin's name on the list through the University of Strasbourg. So this discrediting on the one hand and the sheer prestige of the oeuvre on the other is something that is not uncommon, the double fatefulness of dismissal and the unquestionable weightiness of the name Benjamin, which owns a piece of the turf of the critical and still evolving reception history that bears his name. I'm interested in these clashes and denials, but also, and this is perhaps part of the structure of a polarity, in the uncomplicated attachment to Benjamin in highly specified areas of university workstations. We are responsible to his name and its inexhaustible currents, so we are bound to calling out the pitfalls, the false unconscious that accompanies the itineraries of the Benjaminian legacy, even though I would easily pick off the wonderful and probing works written and signed by many of those here in attendance in one form or another at EGS. I have read them and related dissertations with awe and gratitude for the hours spent tirelessly in the archives, in classrooms, where so many theorems were test-driven, I imagine, in foreign cities, tracking him down in his spectral aloofness, and in even more foreign precincts of your own studies, where you were hammering relentlessly, given to stalls and self-questioning, bouts of bad faith, or to moments of narcissistic surges when you felt you were in the zone. Writing on Benjamin is no easy task under the best of circumstances. You may not even know that you are writing on Benjamin, but if you are in the inscripted areas of art or technology or literary acuity, you are writing on and with and after Benjamin. You are the sequel. That is, the beginning, the coming around of Benjamin again. Writing on Benjamin writing or staying on his medial track and close to his relation to plastic inscription and photography requires great discipline and maybe even love. I have not met many haters in Benjamin studies, though it is not uncommon for academics or even philosophers to hate on the subjects they choose and to practice a politics of resentment, bullying, and demeaning their chosen topic. It is not uncommon, but it's not necessarily the rule. I bring this up to consider, in a perhaps unphilosophical mood, the affect level of our responsiveness, generally, to Benjamin. I'm not sure if he is loved, 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 but there is a discernible mood of trust in Benjamin that interests me, even when he veers off, as in the introduction to Goethe, into political overdrive after the trip to Moscow. We can get into this later if you wish, but I do not want to lose sight of the theoretical stakes implicit in the philosophically stunted and sticky notion of affect. What are the terms of the unambivalent embrace that the name Walter Benjamin has encountered in the last decades? It appears that Benjamin has been accepted, but on what terms? In the standoff between the names of Benjamin and Adorno? Or according to what algorithm of encounter? Has Benjamin not retained, perhaps, the status of a traumatic incursion, a destabilizer that needs to be subdued and rendered each time a bit less inassimilable? It could be that the work and signature Benjamin, in some respects, organizes a hazing ritual for all finely tuned intellectual spirits. Regardless of how close one gets to the Benjaminian oeuvre, one has by now braced and embraced it in the mode of unfissured acceptance. Perhaps this should not be transfixed as an altogether consternating symptom formation. Acceptance, rare and refined, indicates friendly relations, vibrant diplomacy, and deserves to be acknowledged as a critical stance. So maybe we still need to scrutinize what it means to accept a work or a name, though it hardly belongs to the repertoire of stances and aggravated inquiry that Benjamin and Krauss included in their lexicon, and that entailed it in so many instances the rights of nerves. They often preceded by what would piss you off, what upsets you, what gets your nerves, gets on your nerves. That was enough of a heuristic decision for Benjamin and Krauss. I'll be brief on the subject of acceptance, as it might have been at one time with me. All I need to urge at this moment, and very provisionally, not as a destructive character, which is one of Benjamin's figures, or party pooper, but to allow us to put on our night goggles and illuminate inert forms. I want to remind us, in my capacity as one of Kafka's figures for the singer or speaker, Josephine of the Mausvolk, with whom I identify, that we want to recognize, if only momentarily, that acceptance can itself function as a mode of denial, as Verneinung and Verschiebung and Verwerfung and the other series in the Ver vocabularies of psychoanalysis, those disses, disavowal, displacement, and so forth. Sometimes saying yes to a name, to an oeuvre, attaching to it, investing it, and this is why I was so pleased when Wolfgang revealed yesterday that he hates Heidegger. So he refused the yes in a certain way. So sometimes saying yes to a name, to an oeuvre, attaching to it, investing it, reoritizing the oeuvre can function as a way to block it off in the mode of absolute Ausstoßung, or pushing away. It's a way of serving the work, the name, the work and the name, an eviction notice, or kicking it to the curb, relegating it, in the best of cases, to the districts of its own inoccurrence. This predicament is not necessarily what happens or fails to happen when we overexpose and overinvest and outspeak and run out the clock in the way we do at times, because there are always spectral traces and the subterranean strains of a logic that emerge according to another metronome and series of determinations, especially when we are faced with an oeuvre that has shown the pumped vitality of a cult life. Abysses that need to be cleared in terms of the trope of popularity is something that Kant already took up. So I'm still on repetition compulsion here. Why is it that the most difficult discursive formations become popular? The problem of philosophy's popularity. Why is it that everyone knows now Schopenhauer, Einstein, Picasso, Rembrandt, and that bathroom walls recurrently lob one over to Nietzsche, retorting, "Nietzsche is dead, signed God." I would link Kant's struggle with his own popularity to something that has been happening to Benjamin, though at a different pitch and level, following a different notion of sequentiality, remembering and ditching, return and lapse. The task of the graduation lecturer, Josephine of the Mausvolk, is perhaps to strike some keys and perhaps sound the alarm, to open a number of dossiers and set up the rules and regs for what can, and in some cases cannot, occur around a given topic or series of claims. I don't necessarily like to assume this position because I am a natural cheerleader, especially at my own school grounds here at EGS, where one is always only on the brink of disaster. A wonderful rapport to one's work and the disaster of life. I don't know about you, but I stand by Benjamin because I still cannot swallow or come to terms with what happened to him at the pass. I measure my friendships by who would show up for me at that pass, but this is narcissistically annexing him, and I'm sorry and ashamed suddenly to make it about me or my annexations of Walter Benjamin right here, encrypted. Ugh, ugh. I know, for instance, that some among you would show up with a stash of laundered money and a new passport if I were, and I am every day, every night, Benjamin, trying to cross that border and failing to do so, sweating with fatigue and the measure of my own powerlessness because I cannot schlep my heavy suitcases across the mountain path. I am weighed down and dispirited, having left a copy of my manuscript with the librarian, Georges Bataille. I've hit the end of my ability to push forward. I think that Benjamin stands there for us, always as utter destitution that I want to support and learn from him as my persecuted teacher. I'm sorry that I've gotten so personal about the relationship or one of the relationships I might have with my Benjamin, resuscitating the way Eckermann wrote of his Goethe. Okay, I will pull myself together now and go on, V-chip, the incorporation of Walter Benjamin, the way I eat and interiorize my texts. No one cares or wants to know. It reveals an inappropriate boundary crossing. I crossed the line. What a surprise. But first, let us contemplate the line, says Heidegger in Über die Linie. Point 05. Since Benjamin has emphasized the cognitive value of the anecdote, let me move on in conclusion without skipping a beat to tell you about a beating I took. Are you in the mood for hearing about my beating? Yeah, you're in. My story tells you something about what happened to me and Benjamin at another impasse, far less worthy of attention, less intrusive or traumatically flashbacking, yet for me all the same quite distressing. This stalled me for a while, holding me back. It was another dissertation drama, this time at Princeton. Okay, full disclosure, cards on the table. The director of my thesis looked at my proposal to work on my dissertation and approved it. After a year of research and preliminary writing spurts, I was ready to roll, hesitant but determined. I was ready to power through some very dense sectors of critical unreadability. My thesis director, he suddenly canceled my account. He said that he would never accept a dissertation written on one who was neither a philosopher nor a literary name, hardly known. A thesis on this boundary parasite would simply not fly at Princeton University. I was crestfallen, muted, had to start from scratch. The thesis was to have been on a certain Walter Benjamin. So here I am in full healing circle, wondering about what might have happened if my original instinct might not have been snuffed out. I don't mind trailing behind and having had a relation in secrecy and shame with Walter Benjamin, with whom I had to break off by paternal decree, as we still called in those days our advisors, our Dr. Vater, which is the German way of designating the advisor. I still insist on being designated by that way. By the way, it means your father, doctor, so on. Though, of course, with some, we used to do it with some rebellious and sarcastic bite. It was Occupy Wall Street or Toronto, avant la lettre, waving appeals, disrupting a programmatic galaxy of restrictions and rules, sitting it out, existentially benched. Back to my aborted manuscript, what was to have been my doctoral thesis on the then little known rumorological spec, Walter Benjamin, I could have been a contender. This reminiscence is offered here today not only as part of an overextended healing ritual, but as a metonymy and allegorical cue for the shredded dissertation that to a great degree may define our very relation to Walter Benjamin. The ruins of writing, the destruction of project, which, by the way, for Bataille would be a good thing. I know a lot of you like to talk in terms of your project, but Bataille puts an end to that nonsense, so we can talk about that sometime. Being perpetually left back like the Kafkan Dummkopf, who gets the commencement prize by accident almost and miscalling. Benjamin was hounded, beaten, and defeated. He was a relative of the great poet Heinrich Heine, also on the run, or rather on the panting end walk. The world has no doubt changed since then, but not enough. My intention for this evening was to scale back a little and address the modalities of pain and the sustained humiliated cringe, the schreiben schrei, the crie crie, the grito escrito, or the inscribing cry that traverses Benjamin's work. I wanted to take it all the way through to shaming and naming, to the pummeling and bullying that Benjamin allows for, denounces, but he also gets off on it. His anarchistic enthusiasms, his engagement with violence, whether divine or street-meted. My one-way street was taking me to Peter Fenves' work on color, the color of shame. Bright colors associated with children and so-called primitive cultures. Not what you see in most Princeton boutiques, by the way, subdued, more wasp color-coded garments. So one could take this theory of color through Goethe, Kleist, and Lyotard, which always have racialist overtones and undercurrents, and that would be a topic on itself. So let me, point 06, round off the curriculum of this presentation, backup, restart, sequelized by running start. Philippe Lacoue-Labarthe has said that the 20th century can be seen as having established three major categories defining thought and essential action: struggle, task, and mission. Struggle, again, belongs to the Marxist intervention. Task reverts to Benjamin, and mission was assigned to us by Heidegger. Heidegger was on a mission. Benjamin signed up interminably for a task that traveled according to different velocities than those motoring the Marxian struggle. The three tracks that Lacoue-Labarthe laid down for us in order to lend firm structure to the travelogues of 20th century thought do not require us to practice a politics of non-contamination. There was surely struggle in scaling and backsliding on the Aufgabe, and there was a hint of mission, if messianically inflected, in every task that Benjamin set himself as translator of world historical stalls and allegorical disruption. One is always leaving the scene and the stage empty-handed, says Benjamin, coaxed by melancholia. So here, too, we could raise the issue of affect, of feeling. What Lyotard has said, philosophical thought has failed to nail, that philosophy, according to Lyotard, still needs to get with feeling. Task may not imply the intensity of libidinal surge that can be ascribed to struggle, and slightly differently calibrated to mission. Struggle and mission may not be drop-dead impossible the way task is meant to be, though they may in the final analysis all share the same GPS and end up in a historical ditch. Nonetheless, Benjamin's surrender, the way he located giving up at the heart of the task, even the gift of surrender or the gift of death, the Gabe in Aufgabe, I must apologize for the shorthand that has me racing through Derrida's registry, indicates a rhetoric of the stall, the unworkability at the core of doing, the giving of pause, gives him an edge of ethnicity that binds us today. I have quite a bit more to say in this trailer or teaser and a number of scenes of traumatic disruption, but I will cut myself down to size, staying with only a small cluster of blends, a nanosecond now, with which to conclude what was meant to open our discussion tonight. I'm so infused with Benjamin, among the most invested figures in my own repertoire of engagement, my own sense of ruin and blocked passageways, allegorical empty-handedness, that I cannot tell if the melancholia that sets the tone for my being in the world is somehow original with me and my so-called experiences, or a knockoff of his oeuvre, a splinter of hysterical identification and adoption policy. 2 years ago, in a conference on disruptive kinship with Judith Butler and me, Cixous admonished, "You must adopt." So she wanted us to veer away from so-called natural affiliation or bonds. She said, "You must adopt." I would put this perlocutionary speech act up there with Lyotard's, "Il faut enchaîner." You must link up with the unsayable, meaning that when you think thought can't go there, you have to try to link up with the unsayable. You must connect to the unthinkable. "You must adopt" brings us back to Benjamin's reading of the Wahlverwandtschaft in the, what's it in English? Goethe's elective affinities, where he traces the powers that emerge from the disintegration of the marriage over which Goethe frets, jamming relentlessly on his insight into the declining relation, reviewing this from marriage's decay. Now, Goethe was pushing 60 and nothing's working for a rogue libido that pumps up on what Goethe calls wiederholte Pubertät, a crisis in adolescence that I try to link to politics in another area. But this is yet another story. Human beings must manifest the violence of nature, Benjamin says. I know many of us are now reflecting on violence. According to Benjamin, we must manifest the violence of nature. He asks faithfully, following the great theme of delusion, do we have any choice over whom we love, over anything at all? I would want to tie this back to our love for Benjamin, and I am not trying to turn my clip into a Hallmark card, though I am always on the side of deep thoughts. I want merely to turn to the melancholic that I borrow, or rather take, in a violent sweep of surrogation from Benjamin, a stance or Stimmung or disposition or even Gestell that graft originarily, prosthetically, adopting, making it my own by injecting myself with Benjamin's melancholia. In so doing, I remember what my teacher Derrida said about this state of affairs. Turning melancholia, in turn, into an injunction, he said, if I remember correctly, that melancholia is a way of remembering, refusing to forget. Le mélancolique est celui qui refuse d'oublier. Resisting the appeasements of forgetting, the closing of woundedness over time, holding vigilance and incessantly reviewing that which cannot pass. Il faut de la mélancolie. We must have melancholy.